So as Ingrid mentioned, together with Roan and Furkan, I work on lightweight trusted computing. And so the goal of today's presentation is to explain to you what this exactly means, so what it is we do. This is a paper I wrote. So this is a paper I wrote together with Johannes from FAU Erlangen and together with Roan, also from COSIC. So can anyone tell me what's going on in this picture?
Yeah, the remote head of a Jeep, wired journalist, driven into a ditch.
Yes, exactly. So this is to illustrate to you that software and software vulnerabilities can have very dramatic consequences in the real world. So this Jeep is one example. There's also reports of attacks of fridges. So fridges were made out to send spam. And so you have this attack by two researchers who managed to exploit a Jeep. Initially they had to be in the back seat of the car, but about a year later, in 2015, they even managed to find a remote vector to attack the car. And so, as Danilo mentioned, they put a wired journalist into this car, they put him on the freeway, and then at some point they cut his brakes, so his brakes didn't work anymore, they could take over steering. So this guy was really barreling down the freeway, and didn't have any control over his car anymore. And maybe one final example is the well-known Stuxnet virus, which targeted Iran's nuclear facilities, presumably by the US and Israel. And they manipulated the facilities centrifuges, and so it just shows all these attacks. They show that the consequences of software vulnerabilities can have very large consequences. So what does it then mean? So what does trusted computing then mean? There's this quote. No one really knows anymore who said it, but it's often used to explain or to define trusted computing. And it says that an entity is trusted if it always behaves in the expected manner for the intended purpose. So what this means is that if a user knows how his device should behave, an attacker cannot make it do anything else. So it will always behave in that way. Now this talk will focus on hardware-based architectures because we are part of the hardware group after all. And the reason for looking at hardware-based architectures is that there's always limitations of software-based approaches to trusted computing. Because on the one hand, a software-based approach can never be used to give you guarantees against a system-level attacker, so someone who manages to exploit the operating system. And then on the other hand, by rooting your trust in hardware, this allows you to really the hardware is immutable, so an attacker can never change the hardware, so you cannot control this hardware. So you can always trust, at least to a very large extent, you can trust that your hardware will not change. And so if you have a component which is designed in hardware to behave in a certain way, a software attacker cannot make it behave any different. This is the goal of today's talk, and this is also like the final outcome of the paper that he wrote. And it's a comparison of 12. Papers, 12 architectures that have been published over the past 10 years. And so we looked at all of these papers, and so we defined two big categories of properties and features. First of all, we looked at security features, which are very specific to trusted computing architectures. And we also looked at some architectural features that you expect from computer architectures in general, features we thought were interesting to look at in this context of trusted computing. And then in the third column, we list some more general information about the architectures we wanted to highlight. So today's talk, so we've already had the introduction. I will next give some background on trusted computing, but also on computer architectures in general a little bit. Then we will look at the attacker model that these papers consider, followed by the properties, so the security properties that we've just seen, the architectural features, and then finally comparison and conclusion. So first of all, something that's very important in modern computer architecture is the memory hierarchy. So because We only have a very little amount of very fast storage available. So these are the CPU registers. And we have somewhat slower, but a little bit bigger storage, which are the computer's caches. And then finally, you have a vast amount of main memory in any computer. But so whenever you're using data in your processor, you will always traverse this memory hierarchy. So worst case, if you request some data, you have to go all the way down to main memory. But then, so once you've accessed it once, it will typically be cached in the cache, and then you have faster access on subsequent when you need it subsequently. But so, especially in, for example, an Intel processor, these caches, they will have multiple levels. So you'll have level 1, level 2, and even level 3 cache. So these hierarchies make our life a little bit more complex. And then something else I also want to say here is this distinction between instructions and data. So typically in main memory, these will be just mixed throughout. So you will have instructions and data mixed throughout memory. But for a lot of what we do, it's important to look at the distinction between code and data. So any binary will on the one hand have its code, so its instructions that are executed. On the other hand, will have its data, either constants or dynamically changing data at runtime. And so we often make a distinction between these two, as we will see later. Then something else that's present in many modern computers are protection rings. The ones you see in the center are Intel's protection rings. So Intel, these are essentially privilege levels. So depending on what protection ring you're in, you can either execute some instructions or you can't. And so Intel has four rings, from ring 0 up to ring 3. But especially microcontrollers, they will typically only have one execution mode, so there you won't make this distinction. And then somewhat simpler processors, for example, ARM's designs, they only have a supervisor mode and a user mode. So supervisor mode is higher privilege, user mode is lower privilege. And so in user mode, so in ring 3 on the x86, you will typically find applications. Then all the rings below are higher privileged and will run the operating system, kernel, device drivers, so things which require higher privileged instructions. So now let's get to the basic background on protected, on trusted computing, and start with protected module architectures. This is a very important idea in trusted computing. And it was observed that by McCune that applications, they continuously get larger. I mean, if you look at the browser or at the operating system kernel nowadays, it's millions and millions of lines of code. And you cannot get any security guarantees from such large code bases. I mean, it's impossible to verify them. And so what you ideally want is you want to like strip out the sensitive parts, and you want to protect these parts. Because these pieces of code, these smaller pieces of code of your application, you can actually verify. And then when you put them in such a protected module, at the runtime, you also have assurances that this code will execute as you expect it to execute. Something else that's very important in guaranteeing this protection is the trusted computing base. And this trusted computing base consists of all the components in your system, in your trusted computing architecture, that you have to trust inherently. So this means that if one of these components doesn't perform its functionality anymore as it was designed to do, all the security in your system will fail. So as soon as this, as one of the components in the TCB is compromised, your whole trust, I mean, the whole trust chain that you've built up will crumble, and so you won't have any guarantees anymore about the security of the system. This TCB will typically consist mostly of hardware components, but there can also be software components in the TCB. And so this comes back to what I mentioned earlier, is that because of the limitations of software, we want to put these trusted components, we want to put them in hardware as much as possible. And we also want to limit the amount of these components, the number of components that you have. So we want as few components in this TCB as possible. So then, let's look at the attacker model. In general, we see that although all of these papers have their own specific attacker model, you can tell that they have they share a lot of commonalities. There's some specifics, some of the specifics will change, but in general, all of these attacker models in all of these architectures are very similar. So, first of all, an attacker is always allowed to control any software outside of TCP. So that means he can exploit the operating system, can do with it what he wants, can change BIOS settings on your machine, he can fully exploit any application that's running on the system, so he's full of control over any software on the system. Furthermore, he's always also allowed access to external communication channels. So if your device has an uplink, you will be allowed to control that uplink. It can be man in the middle. Next, regarding cryptographic primitives, typically we assume the Dolev-Yahr model, which states that if you have a construction like a block cipher or a hash function, then an attacker cannot break this primitive. So we assume that the primitives that are used are secure. Sadly, these architectures do not prevent any denial of service attacks. So it's typically even possible to use the mechanisms that are offered to perform a denial of service attacks. So these are considered to be out of scope. Hardware attacks are also not considered in our work. We do consider it an orthogonal problem. So we know that there are measures you can take against these types of attacks, but we do not consider them ourselves. There are some exceptions. So a very specific type of hardware attacks, like attacks on main memory and on buses, are allowed in some architectures. So very specifically targeting only main memory. And so software side channels, so where you use, for example, cache timing attacks to figure out information about cryptographic implementation running inside a protected module, are also excluded from the attacker model in most architectures. So let's now look at the security properties that are offered by these architectures. So first of all, we have a very important one, which is isolation. So isolation gives you an access control mechanism. So it will make sure that an attacker cannot, unauthorized applications or even other secure modules cannot access code and data of a protected module. So these are fully isolated. It's impossible to write to these memory locations. It's impossible to read from them. This is really this mechanism that really protects your code, so that ensures that it can't be tampered with. Of course, you still need to be able to enter your protected module somehow. And so that's why there's typically an entry point. So this is one single memory location through which you can enter a secure module. And this entry point will also prevent, for example, return-oriented programming attacks, because an attacker can only jump to this entry point, so you can't jump to arbitrary memory locations inside your module. So next, we have attestation. Attestation is typically a protocol that's carried out, so you have a verifier on the one hand, and then you have a prover. So this prover is typically the device with the trusted computing architecture, and the verifier can either be a local or a remote third party. So local meaning on the device itself, so another application. And by going through this attestation process, the verifier knows that the prover is in a specific state at a specific point in time. What do we mean by this is, for example, that the prover is running the code that you loaded onto the device and that the code wasn't changed by an attacker, or that its static data hasn't been changed. This is done by measuring the application. This measurement will typically involve calculating a MAC over a specific memory region. And typically we also include a nonce to prevent against replay attacks. And then this measurement is sent back to the verifier. And then at his side, because the verifier also knows what code is running on this device, and because he also has access to the function that was used to calculate the measurement, we can verify this measurement. The one important aspect here too is that these measurements, they are anchored in a root of trust. And what we mean by this is that, for example, if you use in the MAC function, for example, will be implemented in hardware, so it's considered unchangeable, so it's a root of trust. And so this really anchors your measurement and your anchors your trust relationship, because you trust that the implementation of the MAC was done correctly, and so you're sure that an attacker hasn't spoofed your measurement. Ceiling builds on this concept of measuring, and ceiling allows you to protect some code or some data and bind it to a platform state. So once you have a measurement, you know that the system is in a certain state, and so you can use this measurement then to, for example, encrypt some data, and so this data will only be, it will only be possible to decrypt this data again when the system is again in the same state as it was when the data was sealed. Or similarly for code, you could only allow decryption of a certain IP if you know that no other, if, for example, no analysis tools, no assembly analysis tools are running on your system. Then we have an extension of this idea of root of trust. There's two ways of building a root of trust. One of these ways is to do it statically. And this is what's done by Microsoft Secure Boot, where you measure all the software that's going up, that's booting up on your system, so the bootloader, the operating system, any application that's running. But this is, of course, static. So you have done this once at startup, and then you don't know what's going to happen afterwards to the system. So code can change, and an attacker can intervene on the system. So another way of building a root of trust is to do it dynamically at the runtime. This is more the process that I discussed earlier, where at the runtime you start this measurement, so you know that once you start, that after you've done the measurement, that the system is in this state, and then you protect the state. So you use isolation, for example, you use isolation to ensure that the state cannot change anymore after you've measured it. And so that's what we call a dynamic root of trust, which gives you more flexibility than a static one. Then somewhat easier one, some of these architectures gives you code confidentiality, so we have hardware support to protect code, which is interesting when you want to protect IP. So as I mentioned earlier, some of them do consider software side channels. So hardware side channels are out of scope, but some architectures protect against software or specific types of software side channels. And we define a software side channel resistance in our paper that untrusted software cannot learn anything else about the application except for its I/O behavior. And then finally, memory protection. This builds on isolation, but it specifically focuses main memory. So protecting integrity and authenticity of memory, of main memory, so RAM, and to prevent an attacker from tampering with this memory by injecting data or code or by trying to change values. And so we consider both passive attacks, for example snooping on the bus, but also active attacks where an attacker actively tries to change memory contents. So then I want to talk about all of the architectural features we considered, but I'm just going to highlight a couple of them. First is what it means for an architecture to be lightweight, because it's very hard to really find a definition about what really is lightweight. And so in our paper, we defined it as being an architecture which does not have an MMU. So an MMU is a memory management unit, and it's typically responsible for virtual addressing. So you will find it in high-end desktop and server CPUs, but the low-end microcontroller typically won't have a complex MMU. And so in addition to this, these low-end, these lightweight devices will typically only run a very limited number of applications. They will be running a couple of tens of processes at most, not the hundreds of processes that you see on a desktop machine. Next is preemption. So if you have an architecture which supports preemption, this means that applications can be suspended at any time without their cooperation. And so this is the basis for multithreading, for example, where you stop applications, start another application, stop that one again. And so this is important. Considering preemption is important in trusted computing because it will impact the security of the system. Because you're now switching between different contexts, and so you have to take care that any sensitive data cannot leak, among other things. So this really, mostly, supporting preemption mostly complicates context switching logic in the process. And the final one that we considered was whether the trusted computing base, whether it's upgradable. So as I mentioned before, the TCB can include some software. And this is interesting because by having software components in this TCB, this allows you, on the one hand, this allows you to put more complex functionality in software, so you don't have to implement a complex attestation scheme in hardware. And in addition, you could deploy fixes afterwards, so you could upgrade the TCB afterwards. So there will always be some hardware components in the TCB, but if there are, the interesting thing is that it's really a hybrid approach, because by adding some software to the TCB, you can rely on these hardware features that you have, like an isolation mechanism, to protect these software components, which are also in your TCB, from being tampered with. So next, I will give you three examples of some trusted computing architectures. The first is SMART. It's a lightweight remote attestation mechanism, which was designed by Al Defraoui and others back in 2012. Next, we will look at SANCUS, which was done here at KU Leuven. It was published by Job Norman and others from the computer science department and from COSIC. And then finally, I will quickly talk about TrustZone, which is ARM's trusted computing architecture. So first, SMART. SMART is a lightweight remote attestation mechanism. So this is an implementation of that protocol I showed you earlier, and it's based on hardware features. Furthermore, it's minimal in the sense that it was proven that these components that the architecture has is the least amount of components that you need to implement this scheme. And so on the slide, I excerpted the line of SMART from the table. So you see it only gives you attestation. It also gives you a dynamic root of trust. So you can invoke this attestation process while the device is running. And so it's backwards compatible. I will come back to this later, but so it essentially means that if you have code which was designed or which was compiled for any of the architectures that SMART targets, you can still run your code afterwards. So you don't have to change your code to use it on this device, although you won't get any security features, of course. So let's look at the protocol that's used by SMART. So it's very, it's a simplified version of this protocol, and SMART essentially extends a little bit upon the simple protocol I showed you earlier, in the sense that the verifier can also send an address X to the prover. And so once the prover has done his measurement, if this X is passed, it will jump to this memory location. So how you can typically use this is you will specify an X in the region of code that you've just measured. So the region of code which you know hasn't been tampered with. And then you immediately, anatomically, so there's no way to interrupt this process, you will jump to this just verified region of code. So by doing the attestation, you have a guarantee that the code hasn't been tampered with. And so you immediately jump into that code which you know is correct. And so in that way, you establish a dynamic root of trust. Technically, the measurement in SMART is done by calculating an HMAC over memory with a shared symmetric key K that is known by both the prover and the verifier. This is what the hardware looks like of SMART. So you have a big memory. In this memory, you have an application of the user, and part of the application needs to be attested. And then you also have some smart code, and this smart code is stored in ROM. So this code is fixed and cannot be changed. So this smart code is part of your TCB. And this code is responsible for doing the measurement. So this code will do the interactions with the remote party, and it will rely on a hardware implementation of the Mac to calculate the actual measurement itself. And so the key is also stored in secure storage. And then the fourth component that you need is some secure reset and memory erasure logic. Next, let's look at SANCUS. So SANCUS is a hardware-only protected module architecture, again, for embedded devices. So SANCUS implements this idea of protected module architectures for lightweight devices. And its isolation mechanism is based on program counter-based memory access control. And what this means is that, so each application has a text section and a data section. So the text section is where it's stored, where its code is stored. And its data section is where it will store constants or dynamic data. And so you can see that the text section is an entry point. So when an application, when you want to start executing one of these protected modules, or secure modules as they're called in SANCAS, you will jump to its entry point. Access to the entry point is always allowed. And then once you've entered this entry point, you can only continue executing from this, from within the text section. So if you're executing outside of this text section, you cannot jump to any memory location except for the entry point. And similarly, for the data section, you cannot access any memory location in the data section before when you are not in the text section. So this is done by putting some boundary registers in hardware, and these will always check any memory requests that's being done. Will be verified on the fly against these access control rules. SANCAS also has an attestation mechanism. And so this is SANCAS system model. So SANCAS was designed for wireless sensor nodes, where you have, for example, an infrastructure provider who will manage the node. And so each node can run software modules, so protected modules from multiple vendors. And SANCAS does some clever key derivations to enable the attestation process. So SANCAS has there's a key derivation. So each node has one master key, KN node key. And based on this node key is only known by the infrastructure provider. And then to allow having different software providers and different applications of these software providers, key derivations are done to give each application a unique key. And so this unique key is then used in a very similar attestation process as the one we saw for SMART, to allow the software provider to verify that its code that's now running on the device has not been tampered with. So finally, let's look at TrustZone. So TrustZone is an industry architecture, in contrast to the previous two, which were from the academic community. And what TrustZone gives you is it gives you an isolation mechanism. And, it doesn't give you an attestation, and it gives you a dynamic root of trust. And similarly, it has a hardware-only trust computing base, so does support preemption. And it can also, something else maybe that's interesting is it supports dynamic layout, so applications can be loaded at arbitrary locations in memory. Whereas for SANCAS, we saw before, at least in the research prototype, it requires static layout, so applications can only be run from very specific memory locations. So TrustZone gives you a normal world and a secure world. In the normal world, you will run a rich operating system, for example, Linux or Android. And then in the secure world, you will run a secure kernel, which is much smaller than these modern big operating systems. And so you can verify their correctness. So what TrustZone also gives you, so TrustZone is in fact an implementation of a specification. So it's the global platform trusted execution environment. And so this specification also specifies APIs, which you can use for communication between both worlds. So to communicate from the normal world to the secure world and vice versa. And so the hardware of the processor will ensure that once you're running in the secure world, you're running in a secure mode. And this means that memory locations which have been assigned, for example, to the secure world are not accessible anymore from the normal world. And so in this way you isolate any trusted applications running in the secure world. One important drawback of this solution is that so you only have binary isolation. So what you mean by this is you only have a normal world and a secure world. So anything that's running inside the secure world has the same privilege level. So you still have protection rings in both worlds. So you still have supervisor mode and normal mode, both in the secure, in the normal world and in the secure world. So applications, so trusted applications themselves in the secure world aren't isolated from each other by anything other than the operating system and the memory management features the operating system provides. So if there is a vulnerability in the secure kernel and someone manages to exploit it, which has happened, any application that's running in the secure world is compromised. So that's an important drawback of trust. Finally, a comparison of all the architectures that we discussed in the paper. First of all, almost all architectures give you an isolation mechanism. So only the TPM and SMART don't, but they were not designed to be isolation architectures. So they were designed as attestation architectures. We see some clear design decisions made by designers. First is that in lightweight architectures, many of them are based on program counter-based access control, which is the mechanism that we discussed for Sankar. And then the more high-level architectures, they will typically extend the MMU because they already have a complex MMU and will add functionality to this MMU. The difference between the two is that the program counter-based access control has a very fine granularity, so you can really give access privileges on words at the word level, whereas for the more high-end architectures, you will typically see that you can only specify it either at cache level or even at page level. Next, for the attestation mechanisms, there's a wide variety of approaches. Lightweight, again, we see that it's typically based on a symmetric approach, where you share a key between both parties. More complex architectures, like Intel's SGX, will have more complex protocols, but they are then typically implemented in software, and so this software is then part of the TCP, which gives them more flexibility and which also makes it easier to do the implementation of these architectures and of these protocols. Regarding trusted computing bases, those architectures without any software in the TCP cannot be upgraded, of course. They do give you stronger guarantees because you know that no component of the TCP can be modified by an attacker, so its functionality will always be guaranteed. But we do think that carefully designed software components can really increase the flexibility of a trusted computing design, and so it's definitely worthwhile to look what can be put into software and what really needs to be in hardware. As we've seen, the attacker model is very similar for all the architectures, and they all prevent similar attacks. So first of all, code injection is always prevented by the isolation mechanism. The entry point will protect you against return-oriented programming attacks. So these are attacks where you use fragments of code from other applications and from libraries and chain these pieces of code together to build your attack. The entry point prevents attackers from using code fragments inside your secure module. But of course, if you have a return-oriented programming vulnerability inside the module itself, a protected module architecture won't protect you against that. So it's still possible to exploit any vulnerabilities inside the module itself. Of course, you have to go through the entry point. Finally, the software side channels, such as cache timing attacks, they are only addressed by one architecture called Sanctum. The trust boundaries. What we mean by this is which part of the architecture do you have to trust? These only extend to the CPU package. So what we mean by this is the integer unit, the registers of the processor and the caches. But for example, main memory is typically not included in trust boundary, so main memory is typically untrusted. This also means that main memory needs to be protected against attacks by other mechanisms. We also saw some cooperative architectures. So this comes back to this dynamic memory layout. This means that applications always call each other in a cooperative way. So if preemption is not supported, applications need to just have control to each other. This means that one application could very well use all system resources and not release any. But nice side effect of having a corporate architecture is, of course, that there are no software sidechannels, because there's also always only one application running at the same time. And then finally, two more high level things we noticed is that first is that all architectures that we looked at, all 12, are backwards compatible. Some of them may require code to be recompiled, but in fact, almost all architectures allow you to just take any legacy binary that you have lying around and put them on the system, run them on the system. This is important because all these architectures, they change the instruction set architecture of the processor, adding instructions. But because it's done this way, the feature, the functionality, the security functionality is always opt-in. So this means that, so this allows you to run any legacy application because these legacy applications simply don't use the functionality. But it of course also means that these legacy applications don't get any of the security guarantees that are given to you by the architecture if you, you do use them. And this also brings us to an important remark, is that we think that it's always important to consider what exactly you put in your protected module. We believe that it does not make sense to, for example, if you have some crypto code in your application, to automatically rip out this crypto code and just put it as is in the protected module. Because if this crypto code was vulnerable before, putting in a protected module won't give you that much additional security. So we do believe that when you use trusted computing architecture, you should consider it from like the start of your design and really design your application with this protection in mind, and really use it as such. And then finally, of course, you now have these modules, but you want to get some data in and out, because otherwise they would be pretty useless. And so one way to do this for smaller messages is to pass them along in processor registers. For larger messages, typically you rely upon shared memory regions which are accessible by trusted and untrusted applications. So this is the whole table. I won't go over it here, but so if you're interested in it, we have this paper is published in IEEE's Transactions on Computers. But maybe one thing I do want to highlight is this last part of the table, which you haven't really talked about yet. And the first thing we list there is whether the discussed architecture is open source or not. And so this is something we would like to see change a little bit in our community, is that people open source their designs much more, especially academic ones, because it really gives you a nice base to start from, to build upon these architectures, change them. And so also this column, this part of the table also shows you the target instruction set architecture. And it is interesting in the sense that you see pretty much all the big architectures that are out there are represented in this table. So you have trusted computing architectures both for like small microcontrollers like TI's MSP430 for the AVR instruction set, as well as for like the processors we use in our desktop machines. So Intel x86, and also AMD has recently added some security features to their processors. So in conclusion, trusted computing architecture can give you strong mechanisms rooted in hardware to protect parts of your application, so sensitive parts of your application. All of these architectures give you strong guarantees rooted in hardware. Very few support all the possible trusted computing mechanisms. A final conclusion is that many researchers do not open source their designs, which would be nice to see change in the future. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to take any questions you may have.